flourishing within their specialties and be the first in the know. Listen as we discover the newest green innovations, research the behavioral patterns of animals, and examine how the arts are being studied today. You'll find it all on the Academic Minute.
Listen every weekday afternoon during the KSJE Evening News at 5:30.
Woven with the Arts presents Music of Hope, Not Hate. My name is Mick Hess, and I will begin a 25-part series of music written by imprisoned Jewish musicians during World War II in Nazi prison camps. These ill-fated musicians and composers, ensnared in the Holocaust, prevailed by performing and composing music of profound importance and beauty. Their music will live forever. Please join me the second and fourth Tuesday of every month at 9 a.m. to discover their music.
Hey everyone, it's your host for the World Beat Show, Scott Duran, and I want you to join me every Saturday at 11 a.m., where I take you on a journey around the world and show you traditional and modern style world beat music. Music from Africa, Spain, France, Japan, China, heck, even songs and artists from the United States itself. So join me every Saturday at 11 a.m. only on the KSJE 90.9 FM.
KSJE is supported by San Juan Regional Medical Center, here to meet your urgent and emergent medical needs, whether they are COVID-19 related or not. Medical emergencies happen when you least expect them. Whether it's a stroke, heart attack, illness, or injury, San Juan Regional Medical Center's caregivers are here to provide care to you and your loved ones. Find out more online at sanjuanregional.com. Ten minutes past 8 o'clock. It is Thursday morning, the 3rd of December. Good morning, everyone. I'm Scott Micklin, and thanks for tuning in to KSJE 90.9 FM over the air in San Juan County, 103.3 FM over the air in Durango, and of course, streaming everywhere from our website at ksje.com. Welcome also to our viewers who are watching our visual radio program or streaming this video program live to the KSJE Facebook page, our YouTube channel, and our Twitter account. So we're glad to have you with us however you get here this morning. Great to have you along. Coming up in the next few moments, my guest on the program today, archaeologist Paul Reed, will be joining me to talk about a couple of fascinating things that are in the news recently. An interesting discovery in Norway and another kind of interesting discovery in Utah. We'll talk more about that in just a moment on KSJE, so stay tuned for that. Next hour, of course, it is Thursday. Our local information program about COVID-19 is on the social media platforms at 9 a.m. live and a rebroadcast this afternoon, of course, at 5:06 p.m. on KSJE Radio. A big show for you today. We've got information coming in from the city of Farmington and in San Juan County as things tend to reopen back here after our two-week reset. Also, our local doctors are back with us to talk about all the news about the vaccines that are rolling out across the world. So we'll have lots of information to share with you coming up this morning. Again, it's live at 9 a.m. on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. 5:06 p.m., a rebroadcast on KSJE Radio and, of course, KSJE.com. Megan Culp will be here along with me, of course, as my trusty co-host at 9 a.m. On the radio side of things at 9:06, Mick Hess takes us roving with the arts. Mick is featuring some big brass today on the program, so you'll certainly enjoy that on the radio at 9:06 on KSJE. Don't forget, of course, we're also on Instagram if you want to join us there, in addition to Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. And let's talk briefly about the weather forecast for today. It is a chilly day so far today, a cold morning, but lots of blue sky and sunshine. Expecting that all day today with a high of only 38 degrees this afternoon, 11 overnight, another clear cold night, mostly sunny tomorrow with a high of 44 degrees on Friday, upper 40s on Saturday and Sunday with overnight lows in the teens. And by Monday, we should see highs in the low 50s with clear nights again with overnight lows near 20, but fairly good weather. Again, we are looking forward to the Luminaria display here at San Juan College on Saturday. That annual tradition will continue this year. It is a drive-through only event, but we invite invite you to check it out this Saturday. Again, a free event here at San Juan College, the annual Luminaria display. It is running all night from 6 p.m. until midnight. And, of course, KSJE has special holiday programming to go along with your visit to the San Juan College campus. So hope to see you here safely on Saturday. Let me turn to my guest, who is here with me this morning to talk a little bit about some recent topics in the news about archaeology. Archaeologist Paul Reed is joining us this morning from his home in New Mexico. Paul, good morning. Good to see you.
Good morning, Scott. So glad to be back.
Good to have you back. Of course, there's always plenty to talk about, as you have told me, and you shared a couple of articles with me about some things that are going on. And so I want to start with this interesting discovery in Norway, and this is interesting on a couple of different fronts, isn't it?
Right, it definitely is. It's good news, bad news in a way, because of the change that our planet's going through in terms of climate. Glaciers are pretty much receding all over the world. So in Norway, there's a specific area that's, something like 40 acres or so on a site that seems to have been an ancient passageway, from one region to another. And there are literally thousands of artifacts that are coming out of the melting snowfield and the glacier.
Got you. And so obviously this is very interesting to folks in your line of work, the archaeologists and things like that, because these things have been unseen, unexposed to the elements for hundreds, thousands of years, right?
Right. It's really not unlike coming to a place, an archaeological site, perhaps a deep cave or rock shelter, and then starting to slowly peel that away. In this case, just the retreat of the glaciers and the melting has revealed, just these many, many artifacts that have lain there for a long time. And this particular site, we're not really talking about sort of a buried hoard. We hear about these things at various points in time where people would take their valuables or, their weapons, their spear points, their arrow points, and bury them. This is literally just a series of deposits at a site that people let go of at different points in the past. I think the earliest they're thinking is about 3000 BC, but all the way well into the medieval period and, through the Viking Age, around 1000 CE and all the way to 1500, 1600. So yeah, just a really nice sort of slice of time in Norway.
Right, but not buried, as you said. And so was this maybe like a trash heap or just we'll leave it there and pick it up on our way back? Or what do you think?
Yeah, I think the archaeologists working believe that it's just an area that was used over a period of time, that people would use items and discard them. Now, one of the more interesting things is, numerous dozens of fairly intact arrows that may have been set aside, sort of as a, we'll come back to this.
Right.
So not quite a buried hoard of, gold to return to, but just some items that were not needed at the time. The other thing, of course, is this is a travel route, so it may well be that these were set aside as some sort of surplus cash for people to return to. And, if they expected conflict, maybe as they pass through these different regions.
I see. Maybe lightening the load a little bit in case they come into some other problem or whatever on their trip.
Right. And then having the ability to return and pick up the items again. Some of it is definitely more in the class of people lived at this area or camped for a period of time, discarded their refuse, and then moved on. The glaciers advanced at different points, covered the area, and now, of course, they're retreating. So they're leaving behind, this amazing array of artifacts from the past.
Interesting. And I'm also noticing a boot, I think, or a shoe in this article as well, right, that they're displaying?
Yeah, really well-preserved leather boots. And these are the types of things, and the arrow shafts as well, anything that kind of falls in the category of what we describe as perishable, which is basically organic items that aren't either bone, stone, or hard-fired pottery or metal artifacts from the past. These items don't last on the surface. So if you took this boot and just, threw it out in your yard or, in some other setting, it would be gone within a matter of months or a couple of years at the outside. So the fact that these items are popping up again duplicates the types of settings that we see stratigraphically in and rock shelters, caves, you know, and as we've talked a lot at the deeper sites that, you know, are in our region at Chaco, Solomon, and Aztec. So when things get deeply buried and there's no water, or they get put in water and buried, you know, we've talked a little bit about sort of the caches and the hoards that have been found in different areas and the bog bodies of Ireland and England. So that's a very low oxygen setting. And so when things freeze, of course, you have pretty much a cessation of bacterial activity, and, you know, things just tend to last a lot longer. So, yeah,
right. Interesting.
Another sort of natural laboratory, and we're getting a glimpse at it, so which is interesting and very exciting.
Sure. And it's this cold temperatures that, I guess, kept these things preserved, and obviously maybe if they're not exposed to a lot of oxygen or a lot of the elements, right, if they're buried in snow or ice, that would help preserve them over this time?
Right. And the other thing, really, just even aside from the organic activities of the bacteria and the viruses, is just being out of the sunlight. Because,
right,
you know, our sun's UV A and B radiation is pretty much a destroyer of almost anything over time. So being out of the sun, you know, for that extended period of time is a big part of it as well.
Right. And I know you and I have talked, too, a little bit about the use of technology and kind of discovering some sites that you can use, radar, LIDAR, some of that other high-tech wizardry stuff that you have at your disposal sometimes. But would any of these things have been detectable with that type of stuff, or does the ice and the cold not allow you to see this stuff, or is it just too small?
Well, it's mostly on the too small side, but I know that on this particular site and some others, they have used ground penetrating radar to try and get a glimpse at what's beneath the ground. What that's more likely to pick up, though, are ancient fire hearths, you know, features used to heat and cook food, and occasionally it'll rock structures and other things. So individual artifacts generally are not going to turn up with those particular, you know, with the ground penetrating radar magnetometry. Now, if there's, you know, a significant concentration of stone, arrow, or spear points, then those will leave a signature that can be picked up if they're concentrated enough. So, yeah, and that's something that they've been pursuing here as well, to just really get an extent or get a sense of the extent of this ancient site, and maybe have some kind of a handle on preserving things. Because, you know, what the situation has done, as well as sort of the thrill of discovery, is it creates really kind of an emergency situation for these artifacts, because once they're exposed, they're going to deteriorate rapidly. So, you know, in many cases, we advocate as archaeologists to just leave items out in the field on archaeological sites, particularly, again, if they're bone, stone, ceramic, other hard materials. But for these perishable remains, once they're exposed, they'll go away in very short order, again, on a scale of weeks or months. So this is leading institutions doing the work to, you know, do a pretty intensive collection policy. So if they're able to know that, for example, the leading edge of a glacier is going to retreat at this kind of a rate, then they can plan a little better and, you know, sort of figure out how to create the storage space. Because as we've talked in the past as well, Scott, you know, we're running out of curation space in our museum facilities, really across the country and the world as well. And the cost to keep items continues to rise. So we have to make good choices. Now, in this case, you know, most of the world archaeologists would say, yeah, let's pick up these items so we can learn from them.
Sure. Well, and again, if these are good examples, we're showing the kind of the arrow point that you mentioned earlier, kind of bound to that piece of wood, looks like, right? That spear or whatever it was.
Right.
And this is an article from CNN, by the way, everyone, where we're getting this information from and sharing these photos, which are fascinating. But I would think that maybe if you've got a better example of an arrowhead and a spear that's been discovered, like at this site, as opposed to what you now have in storage, couldn't you swap it out or maybe replace what you've got, because this is a better example of what we're talking about and what you want to share with your audiences?
Yeah, I mean, I think those, for most museum folks and curators, that those would be considered pretty hard choices.
I see.
To deaccession items already in favor of new ones. So, you know, and I you know, there's certainly different angles that we can talk about, but I think most people who work in museums tend to have a fairly conservative, you know, from the actual nature of conservation approach to save the items and to keep them for additional study. But with the space crisis, you know, we're probably approaching the point where some of these facilities will have to make some, you know, perhaps some hard decisions. But again, you know, and beyond just sort of the stone artifacts, which, you know, are certainly very important, the fact that we have spear points and arrow points still hafted to the original shafts, you know, those, we have a lot of those in different places around the world, but the quantities are much lower in a comparison, in a comparative way, to, you know, just items that where the wood and the reed shafts and whatever else was part of that artifact have long ago eroded. So these definitely fall into a special class. And I know that in Norway they're taking the steps necessary to curate these items. But, you know, as the glaciers continue to retreat really everywhere in high elevation settings across the world, we're gonna have more and more of these. So it is kind of good news, bad news on, right, on a number of different fronts. So,
well, unless we can slow that retreat, that's a whole other show. But I hear what you're saying, and I completely understand. And you mentioned kind of the idea of the longstanding policy to try to leave things where they are for archaeology. As you're discovering some of this stuff, obviously this is not that type of thing. If it's on the surface and it's going to be exposed, you need to protect it, take it into custody, whatever, to preserve it. But I know for a lot of other times we've talked about, as you maybe excavate ruins, buried things that are buried, rooms and things like that, a lot of times you backfill that to help preserve what you've studied, and then you can leave it there for somebody else to come in and find 20 years from now, 50 years from now, who knows when, correct? And just document what you found.
That's right. And I think that that's an area, you know, I mean, certainly archaeology has had its critiques, its critics and critiques over the years. And a lot of that's been legitimate. But we are learning through time. And, you know, I think when people were working in decades past and certainly centuries past, they weren't thinking ahead far enough to, hey, you know, I mean, I'm doing some work on this particular project, but there will be a point in the future when there'll be better technology available and maybe we just really want to preserve more of this site. So we have learned to do, you know, much more selective sampling, essentially, on different places, particularly if we're doing excavations, and to leave as much as we can in the field in its original condition as much as possible for the future, really. And, you know, we don't know how that future is going to unfold in many cases. But picking up the items and putting them into museum collections in areas where they may never really be displayed or see the light of day doesn't seem like such a great choice, really, you know, for most archaeologists these days compared to leaving them again in the field. But of course, then there's the concern about people coming along and just picking them up for their own private collections. So, you know, so there's many things to balance, you know, as we consider the issues.
Sure. Understood. And, but of course for the public that gets to go see some of these things, you know, it's kind of that balancing act of what do you excavate and what do you show and stabilize things, places like Aztec ruins, Chaco Canyon, Mesa Verde. We've lots and lots of examples here. But again, even at those sites, not everything has been excavated and is on display for tourists to come and look at because, probably economics is part of it, and time and money, and other reasons to preserve some of those unexcavated ruins, right?
Right, and you know, the other issue is for these larger sites, there are literally hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of items that have come out. So, we would need many, many, many more museum facilities. You know, the other thing that I think we've seen over a few decades now is a shift in the museum field, and this really covers museums of all different types, not just ones that focus on archaeology or history or the ancient past. And the shift is towards providing more interpretation. So, you know, we can create a display case that has 20, 30, 40 different items that might be spear points, you know, from this area in Norway, which would be very interesting. But what we need to do as well as to pair that with, you know, really detailed interpretation, I mean, at least at the level that we can in a museum setting, and perhaps interactive displays, you know. So it's a pretty exciting time for museums to be able to share some of the actual physical items from the past but then the latest interpretations and then some of the technology that helps us come to a better understanding. So, you know, there's a little bit of a shift there, and that takes us away from simply holding on to these items and showing them without offering enough of an interpretation. So anyway, I think it's a very interesting shift that we're in the middle of.
Right. No, I hear what you're saying, and I understand that, and I agree wholeheartedly. My guest this morning, archaeologist Paul Reed, is here. He is talking about a couple of different topics this morning. We'll get to the second one in just a moment. But one, this discovery in Norway of some really ancient artifacts, again, as some of the ice fields and glaciers melt and retreat. Some of these finds are coming that were right on the surface and not buried, as we sometimes think about. So very interesting. Well, Paul, let me change gears just a little bit and ask you about another another item that's been in the news this week, and that is that crazy obelisk that was found in I guess southeastern Utah, not too far from here, and kind of captivated a lot of the public and questions about where did it come from, how long has it been there, who put it there. It's on public land, and so it's not supposed to be there. And I know you have mixed feelings about this whole episode, right? So tell me a little bit about what you think.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. They have concluded, just kind of with study of Google Earth images and some aerial photography, that it was installed in 2016. So what's particularly interesting to me with, this is a remote area, we should say that at the outset, but that it largely went undetected, at least by, you know, public media for 4 years. And then, you know, once word got out and people submitted some photographs that got into the press, then things move pretty rapidly. You know, and I think there's different opinions, but I think what I've heard from folks who are up in the area and a little closer to it, maybe than the rest of us, is that this was some kind of art installation that an individual put up, you know, on, again, as you said, on BLM, on public lands. You know, there's no indication that a permit was requested or that something like that would have even been granted.
Right.
Then, you know, again, some friends in southeast Utah just on Facebook in the last couple of days sort of broke a story that then got into the bigger part of the media, where, you know, they encountered people going there after dark a week plus ago with a wheelbarrow, four individuals who knocked this thing over, dismantled it, and carted it off.
And we're showing a story from the New York Times about that part of it. Yeah.
Yeah, and there was a friend of a friend who actually witnessed that and who then got interviewed, and this kind of went down the line until the story broke. So that's an interesting part about, obviously, how we get our news these days and, you know, the lines of transmission of information. And, you know, I think there's a variety of opinions out there, but I think, you know, it's likely that the people who deconstructed it were not the ones who installed it. So,
right.
You know, and they weren't acting in a government capacity. There weren't uniforms and, you know.
Exactly.
So, yeah.
And there's some pictures of the team, I guess, taking it down and taking it away in the dark of the night, as it were, right? And so.
Right.
And maybe that was part of it. I can see it as an art installation. You know, we've seen that before in cities and open areas around the world, right? As artists want to kind of do a large scale installation or something, maybe usually temporary, but they go through the permitting process and get the permission of all the necessary entities to do something like this. That doesn't seem to be the case in this particular time. But and again, the fact that I think it's fascinating that it's been there for so long, but only recently maybe discovered or promoted, or through the use of social media and the internet, that the news spread and folks were able to see it until it wasn't there anymore, and that was just within the last 10 days or so.
Right, and you know, for the artist who installed it, or artists, you know, we don't know. An interesting difference between doing that and doing a very public display somewhere, like you said, with the permitting, and somewhere where, you know, thinking Central Park in New York, right, where millions of people would see something, you would be acknowledged as the artist. This is much more sort of a personal project, right? You go put this thing into a very remote location, and maybe, you know, it was as much about seeing how long it would take for people to find it and talk about it and have it sort of break into the rest of the world, at least the public world.
Right.
And, you know, 4 years is a long time. So it'd be interesting to dig a little deeper and find out how many local folks out there knew about it and just didn't talk about it to the point where, you know, the rest of the world got interested.
Very true. But as you mentioned, this is in a rural spot, right? And so I guess it just goes to show maybe how rural parts of the West still are, that these things don't get encountered on a daily, weekly, monthly, even yearly basis, perhaps. And that's why it was undetected for so long. And I think how it came to our knowledge was some government folks were on a helicopter surveying mission and spotted it from the air. Isn't that how it happened?
That's right. That's right. And the fact that it had to be removed, you know, with a wheelbarrow tells you that this wasn't drive right up and
throw it in the back of the truck. Yeah, exactly.
And move on. So, yeah.
Interesting.
It's an interesting world, right?
Very true. That's very true. Well, that brings me to another question a little bit about like some of this stuff, though, because as an archaeologist now, obviously, a stainless steel obelisk, you know, we can certainly kind of, even I can date that and know that it wasn't there, you know, for thousands of years. But, you know, in the work that you all do, you know, how do you try to determine? I know there's technical ways to do it and carbon dating and some of those things, but, you know, some of these sites have been trampled on and maybe inhabited off and on for hundreds of years, thousands of years. And so I know there's layers and things like that you can try to date certain artifacts that you find, but is there other ways and other things that you really try to make sure that what you're saying is this particular piece of pottery came from this particular era to be able to determine it when things have been kind of intermingled over time?
Right. Yeah. It's an interesting process and challenge because really, literally every time we go in the field to do things, that's going to be one of the key issues is we find a cultural site, an archaeological site, an historic site. When does it date and who created it? You know, those are the key questions that we're trying to answer. So if we go first to an excavation approach where a site is being excavated, then we generally get a lot more clues. If we're peeling away layers, we're looking at, say, an ancient Pueblo pit house, and we've gone through it and we found the pottery that suggests it's in this time period. We find, you know, intact pieces of wood that can be tree ring dated. You know, so on the excavation side, with enough time and enough material data collected, we can generally be pretty sure in our neck of the woods, you know, and come up with dates that are at least down to decades. The real challenge is in a survey situation. So let's say we were wandering about in southeast Utah and found this obelisk. As you said, it's a metal object. It's going to look fairly new. It's not going to be rusted, presumably, you know, so we can put that somewhere in time. But, you know, on generalized survey projects, if we're out looking, you know, we have to rely on the clues that come from the materials that were used to build something. As you said, what kind of pottery's on it and how well do we understand a particular pottery type? Is it a big enough piece of pottery for us to say, oh, this fits into this category we call this? You know, are there projectile points and arrowheads that might fit a particular typology? You know, so we have all these different clues. And for most of those, we can get things down to at least a couple hundred years. Sometimes we're at more of a couple thousand years, depending. But let's talk about, like, rocks, for an example. You know, rock cairns are all over the world, all over our region. People can build these, and actually there's a movement on some groups on public lands are encouraging people not to do this because what we get sometimes is a real proliferation of just rock piles, cairns, right, we call them, and they can end up marring, you know, what's otherwise a natural landscape. And of course we use these for trail markers that, you know, both in the present and the past, that's typically what we see. But if people have piled up rocks, we can sometimes tell that they're more recent compared to older. You know, when rocks lay in a flat position for a long time, lichen grows on them, and you can tell if, you know, a rock pile or even the foundation of an old structure has been there for a long time. The rock cairns are a little more challenging because a lot of times people move those around, like you said, And, you know, and we end up doing what I describe as archaeology of the very recent past many times. So we get into a situation where we know we've got, say, a 1,000-year-old site, but then there are some other things that have happened on that site since people left it at, say, AD, you know, 1,000 or so. So people come along, they move the rocks, they build another structure, maybe a sheep herder comes along, builds a little temporary structure. So, you know, this archaeological landscape, the historic landscape is constantly changing, literally, with every group of people that comes on. So it is, you know, pretty much a continual challenge to go through the process.
Right. And I suppose then from what you've learned and what you can glean from the different artifacts that are left behind or the structures that are left behind or parts of the structures, you can maybe tell if they were used and reused. I mean, even we see that, I think, at some of the ruins in this area from some of the inhabited periods at Chaco Canyon or even Aztec ruins, that maybe rooms were used for one purpose and then changed and then had a new, different purpose later in life and those types of things. And obviously those come from the telltale signs you can still discover in modern day.
Right. I mean, it's, you know, it's a very dynamic record. And, you know, what I ask people to think about their own houses, right? We build our houses, we move in, and we decide we're going to paint a room a certain color. And then that lasts for a period of time. Maybe our kids grow up, you know, other people move in. So then the needs of the house shift, and maybe add on a room, maybe close off a room. You know, so that continual process of remodeling, this applies to the past as well. We have very durable archaeological and historic site locations that go through many, many transformations, you know, as people live in them for decades or even centuries. So, yeah, it's really one of the things that makes the work that I do and that other archaeologists and researchers do just very interesting and challenging. As you come to a location and then you immediately have to start thinking about who created the site, how long was it used, who came along later, and sort of piecing all those different, you know, components together, if you will.
Right. Well, it's fascinating, Paul Reed. It always is, and our conversations are fascinating too. I always appreciate them and you for sharing your knowledge with us every month. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Scott. I'm thrilled to do this, and, you know, we'll come back, and maybe the temps will be a little warmer in January, right?
Well, maybe they will. We'll have to see, and I just want to make sure our viewers understand that now behind that blue curtain, there's not any stainless steel or anything, right, that you're hiding from us?
Well, there's no telling where the next obelisk will appear.
Right, well, gotcha. But you haven't been to Romania recently, so I think you're off the hook. Thank you, Paul. Nice to talk to you. Happy holidays to you and your family. Thanks.
Thank you.
You bet. That's archaeologist Paul Reed, my guest here on KSJE from Archaeology Southwest. I'll be back with more, of course, coming up in just a moment here on KSJE. The time right now is 8:41. KSJE is supported by the University of Denver Graduate School of Social Work Four Corners Program. The program is accepting applications for the Advanced Standing MSW program starting this summer 2021. Students with a bachelor's degree in social